Hi, I'm Carol Anne Riddell, and welcome to Book It with CA. I'm a big fan of historical fiction because I love a great story that weaves in events that actually happened. It's a delicious literary combination and a fun way to learn about a time period or person. If you agree, settle in. We are taking a deep dive with two authors who explore very different but fascinating topics. Patricia Morrisroe, whose book is The Woman in the Moonlight, and Jess Walter, author of The Cold Millions.
Patricia, Jess, thank you so much for being with us today. I'm so glad to see you both.
Thank you. I'm thrilled to be here.
Yeah, thank you, Carol Anne.
So I want to start by saying I loved your books, both of them, and I learned a lot also, both historical fiction. I want to start by talking a little bit about the books and how the stories unfold. Patricia, do you want to jump in with The Woman in the Moonlight?
Yes. I had never had a desire to write historical fiction. And I went out to lunch with an editor, an old friend of mine, and he threw out the idea that Beethoven had fallen in love with one of his young piano students, and he thought it would make an interesting novel. And I followed it up from there. So it really was not my idea. It was a kernel of an idea that obviously I expanded on a lot because he didn't even know her name.
Wow, that's really interesting. And so, Jess, your book is The Cold Millions. Can you tell us just a little bit about the story?
Yeah, I think for me too, the idea of writing historical fiction wasn't the first thing that drew me. I was a journalist by training. And so I was really drawn to the idea of writing about income inequality, the thing we're experiencing now, and civil unrest and some issues that felt to me like they resonated in the period I wrote about, 1909, in the Pacific Northwest, and the industrial workers of the world, the Wobblies, and their battle to get basic rights for indigent workers, for hobos and bums and tramps. But I also wanted to write a kind of end of the West Western, full of large archetypal characters. So I really hoped to wed this sort of social novel that I grew up loving with something big and adventuresome.
Yeah. Let's talk a little bit more about The Woman in the Moonlight, Patricia. So obviously both the books are a blend of fact and fiction, and it's widely known that Beethoven did suffer from hearing loss. But what did you learn about that as you were writing the book?
Well, I learned that he started to lose his hearing in 1798. He was in his late 20s. He had tinnitus, which was a ringing in his ear, and then he had difficulty hearing the high notes. I think he thought it would probably go away. It didn't. And by the time he meets Countess Julie Guicciardi in 1801, he's really grappling with the concept that he will lose his hearing. And he, at the time, he wasn't so much worried that he was going to not be able to compose music. He was the greatest piano virtuoso in Vienna at the time, and he knew that he would it would probably end his career. Ultimately, no one knows for sure what caused the hearing loss. It might have been a lead poisoning, but they don't really know.
Wow. And he did continue to compose throughout.
Oh, yes. I mean, the biggest misconception is that Beethoven was stone deaf. That is not true. Beethoven's hearing loss was progressive. And even by the time he did the Ninth Symphony, he could still hear somewhat. We've discovered this recently because a Beethoven scholar named Theodor Albrecht translated some of his conversation books, and you see that he's still talking about having some hearing in his left ear. So he was pretty much functionally deaf by the 2 years before he died, but he still could hear somewhat. I mean, not phenomenally well.
So Jess, there are some historical figures and events, obviously, in your book. I was really struck by Elizabeth Gurley Flynn, and to be honest, I did not know much about her before I read your book. She is 19, she is pregnant, she is a force of nature. Can you tell us about her?
Yeah, it was really one of the things that I sort of hoped to reclaim from you know, the historical dustbin, I guess. I think because the labor movement of the early 1900s doesn't get taught and has sort of been, you know, we go from the old West to World War I to the Great Depression. We sort of skip over this entire period. And reading about this, you know, young labor activist and suffragist in 1909 was fascinating. And she had really come to my hometown, Spokane, Washington, to lead this fight against a corrupt police department and the wealthy mine and timber owners who were really abusing these workers, really, you know, taking advantage of them, paying them a dollar, making them pay for their work and their own medical care. And yeah, as a 16, 17 year old, she left home to go west and fight for these workers in some of the roughest mining camps ever. By the time she got to Spokane, she was pregnant. She and her husband were in the process of splitting. And even though even the union leaders didn't want her on street corners, she just would not be told no. And it was interesting writing this historical figure. In Seattle, she gave this speech in which she not only demanded rights for workers, but the emancipation of the vagina. And my British editor said, this seems unbelievable to me, this character saying this in 1909. And I said, that's the only true thing in the book. You know, the rest is fiction. The audacity of that character as a fiction writer is one you want to try to create on the page. And, she's not the protagonist of the novel, but I always imagined if I was writing a Western, this was my Clint Eastwood character riding into town to battle the corrupt, forces that be, and to have a pregnant 19-year-old Clint Eastwood was something as a storyteller you really want to try to find your way into.
So Patricia, let's talk about Countess Julie. And I know you said she's based on a real person, on one of Beethoven's students, but what else do you know about her and about the relationship?
Well, I think the key thing about Julie is that Beethoven dedicated the Moonlight Sonata to her. And the Moonlight is perhaps the most popular piece of classical music in history. We know that she was his piano student, that he was in love with her. We know that from a letter that he wrote to a childhood friend from Bonn, where Beethoven was from. You know, he said, he called her his dear enchanting girl. She loved him. She loves me, I love her, but it's doubtful that we'll be able to marry because she's not of my station. And Beethoven, as brilliant as he was not an aristocrat. So I knew that about Julie, and I knew that obviously with the dedication, there had to have been some kind of infatuation, love affair, but I didn't have a lot to go on. Originally, I was just going to base the novel around Moonlight Sonata, but then in doing research, as people tend to do, I found that she had moved to Naples and became a spy for the King of Naples. This was in a footnote in some French book that I found. And then ultimately she came back to Vienna with her husband and another man. They took over the Kärntner Theater where Beethoven had premiered the Ninth Symphony. So I was able to bring their story full circle and make sure that it was rooted in history, although because there was not a lot of research on Julie, she was a fictional character for the most part.
Talk about another theme that is in both of your books, and Jess, that is class struggle, which you've already touched upon, but this very stark divide between the haves in the book and the have-nots. And you know, I was really struck by this one moment when Rye, one of the boys, is in the home of this wealthy man, Lembrand, and he is, as you describe it, like overcome by the too muchness of it. And I found that passage to be very moving. And I wonder if you could talk a little bit about it and also That is, I believe, where the title comes from. Is that right?
Yeah, that's right. He is in Lembrand's grand library, floor to ceiling, gilt-edged books, and his brother Gig, who is in jail, is actually loves reading. In fact, one of the things that really struck me in reading about this time was what they called the Great Hobo Library. That these men on trains and in hobo camps would, you know, there's very little room in the bindle you carry on your back, and yet many of them would carry a book and trade books over campfires. And that way, thousands of books existed out on these hobo trails. And so Gig has fallen for War and Peace. It's his, even though he's the sort of autodidact who, even though he only has educated himself to about the age of 14, has decided the 2/5 of War and Peace that he's read are the greatest work of literature known to man. And so in that moment, Rye is in this great library of these unopened books. You know, it's purely a show library. And he thinks, how sad it is that his brother will never know a room like this. And in that moment, I think it sort of cracks open a kind of humanity for him. He thinks of all the people, the cold millions, who will never be in a place like that. And I think he's always known that there were these levels between wealth and poverty. And so he believed that a man like this was 10 times wealthier or 20 times, but to realize that it's almost an infinite gap, an unbridgeable gap, I think it breaks his heart.
Money and class are also big themes in your book, Patricia, because they in many ways define Beethoven's experience as a composer and sort of what his personal life can look like and the need to have someone supporting his life as a composer. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Well, yes. I mean, Beethoven was really the first freelance musician. Somebody like Mozart had to write music for the church. He had to do what, you know, basically he was told to do, whereas Beethoven could do what he wanted because he had very powerful patrons. I mean, here and there he would dedicate pieces to them, but it was something that he had an enormous amount of freedom, which most other musicians did not. They were court musicians. They had to do what they were told. But I think the issue of class intrigued me very much with Julie because, you know, the aristocratic women had much more of a confined life than the middle class and the lower class. They could not really marry for love. They had to, in order to attract a husband, become proficient in a musical instrument. And at the time, you know, you had to be careful what musical instrument it was. It couldn't be violin because that was too many slashing movements. I mean, that could show that, oh, this woman could potentially have a bad temper. You couldn't play the cello because you squeezed it between your legs. You had to play the piano because it showed off your beautiful posture and dainty wrists. So every aristocratic woman in Vienna needed to become proficient in an instrument, preferably the piano, in order to get a husband. So for Julie to nab Beethoven as a piano teacher was a real coup. It didn't help out with her marriage, unfortunately, but you know, she was a very good pianist.
Yeah, and as brilliant as Beethoven was, he was not wealthy as a result of that.
No, and he also, I mean, Beethoven was not wealthy. He also moved 68 times. He was not very happy in one spot. He made sure that every summer he had to go to Baden. So he was not, and he had housekeepers. I mean, he was not the most frugal of men, although, you know, truly he wasn't a count. He didn't have the money as, you know, the princes and the counts, but he wasn't as bad off as one thought. And, you know, he had very strange housekeeping habits. I mean, he would leave herring and all sorts of food next to the manuscript of the Ninth Symphony and, you know, spilled coffee. He was, you know, a bit of a slob. And when people went to visit him, they were absolutely appalled. But they also thought he was quite crazy, too. And a part of him was very extreme.
I'd like to talk a little bit more about the relationships that sort of shape both of your novels. So Jess, at the heart of your book is this relationship between the two brothers, and they're incredibly devoted to each other. And much of what happens in the book is motivated by that dedication. Can you tell us a little bit more about how you crafted that relationship?
Yeah, the Rye and Gig are the only two left of their family. Their mother has died of tuberculosis. Their brother has died in a log camp, and their father has died walking into a bar, which he refers to as Irish hell. But they really only have each other. And Gig really is, fond of the road. My grandfather was an itinerant worker, was a hobo in the 1930s, and his stories of adventure, of riding the rails, seemed to me as a kid growing up like stowing away on a pirate ship. And so I really wanted to imbue Gig with my grandfather's, romanticism for the life that he'd led. And Rye is different. He really wants to belong. He's a clothes horse. When he finally gets some money, he spends it on a pair of gloves and eventually wants to buy a suit. And so I think the push and pull of their relationship, having a brother myself, was what interested me. You have that sense of love and responsibility really tied together. And so much so that, there were points when I wasn't sure which one was taking care of the other. It was clear that they both would feel that they were taking care of the other. Going from these work camps, these incredibly dangerous work camps, working in a place when the place where they're born in Montana, coal miners' average lifespan was 34. And so the life that they had to look forward to was, such a dangerous one that, their care for each other really struck me as the central emotional thing in the book.
Yep. That was my sense of it. And Patricia, obviously in your book, it's a love story. It's Beethoven and Julie, but what else can you tell us about that relationship? Or what did you want readers to take away from that relationship?
I think I really wanted to explore the concept of passion and obsession. And for Beethoven, it was passion for music. He was obsessed, obviously, by music. And Julie was very obsessed by Beethoven. And a lot of it had to do with the music. It's funny, everybody always says, do not read your Amazon reviews, but as a writer, how can you not? And someone wrote in, I don't understand, Beethoven was dirty, he was sloppy. I don't know how Julie could fall in love with Beethoven. And my answer is, how could you not? I mean, how could you not, if you have the opportunity to have a relationship with a man who wrote music like that? I mean, the music was so hypnotizing and so mesmerizing. So right. Julie meets him when she's young and is completely enthralled. Then when certain terrible things happen to her, she winds up in Vienna, it winds up in Naples. And I think that obsession and longing takes over because she's not with him. By the time she comes back to Vienna, she's older, she's wiser, and the relationship moves from that obsessive infatuation to a deep love, a deep friendship. So I really wanted to, follow the trajectory of this woman's love affair with really an incredibly extraordinary man. I've spoken to other musicians who played Beethoven's music, whether they've recorded all the sonatas, and they say that, first of all, it's very hard to get him out of their lives. And secondly, they do become obsessed by him. So I think there is that obsessional quality. You hear it in Beethoven's music. And I wanted to bring that out in this woman's relationship.
Would you say that you got a little obsessed with Beethoven too in writing this?
Well, I don't know what I'm going to do. I mean, I was thinking of actually writing an article as their life after Beethoven. And I thought, that's really sad. Don't do that. But no, you can't get him out of your life. You can't. And that's could be a problem. Well, talk to me in another couple of years if I'm still talking about Beethoven.
So I love to understand the process of writing for authors. So I hope you'll indulge me with a few questions on that front. I know that both of you began as reporters, so we all have that in common. How did you find that journalism informed the way you approached these books? And either one of you can jump in.
Well, I had never written fiction before, even a short story. So this was, I mean, this was totally new to me. I had never even taken a creative writing class. Wow. But when you write, you know, I wrote for New York Magazine for so many years, and you get thrown into one week, you're doing a political story, another week, you're doing a cultural story. So I think I approached this in a very naive way. It's like, well, it's Beethoven, there's Napoleon, you do your research and you bring them all in. I think for me originally, I was getting a little, I mean, I made sure in an, again, the word obsession, but I had to make everything incredibly factual. And in the beginning, I think that was hampering the writing a little bit. It was like, loosen up, you don't, and, but obviously, Beethoven is so known that I had to make sure that every time he was mentioned and there was a date, that that was right. Incredibly accurate. And because I'd written a biography before, I took Beethoven's biography, sort of laid it out, and then overlaid my story on top of it. Again, because I just didn't know. I was, you know, learning as I went.
You know, it's interesting to me about historical fiction because it seems to me that it would be almost easier to write something that's purely fiction or purely nonfiction, but how do you find the line between the two things?
You know, I honestly think I didn't know enough to even think that there would be a balance. You know, I think that I was able to create much more with Julie because there was so little known about her. Right. So that had to come completely from my imagination, but then based on what women would have been doing, wearing, everything else at the time. For Beethoven, I read all his letters. A lot of the dialogue in the book is, you know, sort of paraphrasing of his letters. I kept very close to the historical figures. I mean, Napoleon makes, you know, brief appearances, but I think it was with Julie and her mother. The mother was purely made up. I mean, she had a mother, but I created her pretty much from scratch, the father too. So Julie's family, that was the most fictional. For the rest with Beethoven, I was very nervous. You know, there was part of my biographer brain and then part of like, oh, I'm now a novelist. And so there was a bit of a schism, but I kept. And then what's interesting to me, and having never done this before, you suddenly sit down and the characters are talking to one another and they take off, you know, and it's that really exciting creative process that having written two memoirs and having written journalism, that had never happened. And that was really exciting.
So the book gets a life of its own as you're going
through the process. And I've read about this process with writers, but it had, you know, never happened to me before because when you're writing journalism, you know, the characters are just not going off and saying what you want them to say, or you wouldn't be working very long.
Yeah, that's very true.
Yeah, it always sounds mystical to talk that way, you know.
But don't you find that was?
Oh, no, totally. Yeah, totally. I Nabokov one time said this. You know, I hear this rot about characters acting on their own, and my characters are galley slaves. They do exactly as I say, and so sometimes I would think, am I doing it wrong that my characters seem to be veering me in these directions? But I think it is that great imaginative state that you arrive in. And honestly, every reader knows what it feels like. It's when the book becomes real. It's when the characters become real and when you can't put it down and when you start to really care about them. And so to have a surprising line of dialogue or to realize, oh my gosh, he's been thinking this the whole time, you know, is, you know, it's just inhabiting the characters the way you do as a reader, but it's that instant of writing. It's really, I think, my favorite part of the entire process is, you know, when 7 hours passes and you feel like you've been so inside the story.
Well, Jess, Patricia, thank you so much for all this time. I really enjoyed talking to you both. Really appreciate it.
Thank you. This was a lot of fun.
Yeah, it was great fun. Thanks. Yeah. Off to listen to Beethoven right now.
Yeah. Thank you. Closes out another chapter of Book It with CA, but we will be back again soon. In the meantime, please follow us on Facebook and Instagram. We'd love to hear from you, and suggestions are always welcome. I'm Carol Anne Riddell. Thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you next time.